the chapter on wind energy was started in the previous class, and we had talked about some basic things about the wind turbines, kind of the history of the wind turbines, and what were the applications for which it is used. And nowadays, as it was told, it is mainly being used for generation of electrical power, and the three-bladed propeller type horizontal axis windmill is the most common now. But still, before talking about that, we will discuss various things like classification of the turbines, then the basic simple model using which you can define or set the maximum limit for the efficiency or coefficient of power of wind turbines. And then after that, we will embark upon the modern design of the wind turbine and describe the same. So there could be different ways in which the wind turbines can be classified. One of them is classifying them as horizontal axis wind turbine and vertical axis wind turbine. The other way to classify them could be the drag type of machine or lift type of machine. So the horizontal axis turbines, obviously the axis of the turbine, the blades rotate about a particular axis. So that axis, when it is horizontal, it is horizontal axis wind turbine. So the examples are the propeller type of turbine, single bladed, two bladed, or three bladed, as shown in the figure. Simple sketches are shown, or can be American multi-blade type of windmill, as shown as the fourth type of windmill in the picture. Then the vertical axis, there are varieties like one, the 7S design, as it is shown in the figure here on the left-hand side. This actually is nothing but, you can say, two halves of a cylinder are put side by side. And the other one, which is shown on the right-hand side, is Darius type of turbine. So this is the shaft, and the blades have a very typical shape. It's called Troposcatter shape. And to support this turbine, guy wires may be used. So these two designs are vertical axis designs. So this the top view of those two is shown in the figure. So the 7S, you see the front view here and the top view of that here. You can say sectional top view or even top view. So you see two cylinders, so the wind would enter into two semi-cylinders, hollow cylinders. So air would enter from one side into one of them, come out of that and enter the other one, and then come out from the second one. And the Darius type of design that is shown, the top view is shown here, and these blades which are shown here, it is shown two-bladed. It can even be three-bladed. So the blades have a particular shape, the aerofoil shape. So this one is also a lift type of machines, and it is seen that the lift type of machines, even theoretically, it can be shown that the lift type of machines normally give you higher efficiencies. So they are more popular as compared to the drag type of machines, particularly for power generation. So the one which is shown here in the next figure is cup type of anemometer. Cup type anemometer. So this is actually not normally used as a turbine, but rather used for to measure the wind velocity. So this one is also vertical axis windmill. And then the other one, what you see is the wind vane. this arrow like object, right? So that is wind vane. It will orient itself in the direction of the wind, so it will show you the wind direction. So these two instruments are also important in case of wind turbines. The measuring wind velocity and knowing the wind direction are two very important parameters in the control mechanisms that you have in modern wind turbines. Now, if you compare the vertical axis and the horizontal axis windmill, you can state several advantages or disadvantages. Though, like many times, the situation is dynamic and the things change, but still, it might be useful to give advantages and disadvantages of the either. So the vertical axis wind turbines that can operate independent of wind direction, right? So you don't have to it's called yawing mechanism in case of horizontal axis turbines, that is changing the direction it faces. So yaw mechanism is provided for large size horizontal axis machines. So the rotor plane can be kept perpendicular to wind direction, but this mechanism is not required in vertical axis machines. Then the vertical axis wind are not subject to cyclic gravity loads. Okay. So I think you can understand this point. In case of horizontal axis, they move up and down during their rotation, so here that issue is not there. Then the generator, gearbox, so in case of the vertical axis turbines, these heavy components like generator, gearbox, etc. can be put on ground in a smaller vertical axis turbine. Of course, if the blade size is very long, then you have to rethink whether you can put it on the ground also, because a very long length of the shaft would also not be desirable. But at least for smaller vertical axis wind turbines, they can be put on the ground. So they need less structural support and maintenance of these components is easier. Then the vertical axis wind turbines can be placed closer to one another as compared to horizontal axis wind turbines. So the stream of wind that they disturb must be less than less in case of vertical axis turbines as compared to the horizontal axis turbine. And the disadvantages of the vertical axis turbine so vertical axis turbines, you need not worry about the direction of the wind because it is symmetrical. So that way it doesn't matter from which direction the wind is coming. Okay. We will describe the various turbines in more detail later. At that time, perhaps you would have better understanding of some of the things which are being stated here. Actually, now we are talking about vertical axis wind turbines, but later on, what we will discuss more is only a particular type of horizontal axis wind turbine, the propeller one, right? Because that's the one which is being mostly used, right? Just to have some comparison and stating some reasons why vertical axis turbines are not that popular, this point has been put here. So the disadvantages of the vertical axis wind turbines, one is it is found that their efficiency is less, that is power production per unit area is lower. Then the vertical axis turbines are not self-starting, right? So the starting torque is high in that case. So you will need to have a motor to start them. Then there is lack of proven and aerodynamic braking system, right? Brakes are also required to reduce the speed and then stop the turbines in case of emergency or in case of maintenance. Fatigue failure rates are seen to be higher. So efficiency is not the only consideration. Right, you have to see talk about the life of the turbine also. So it's stated that fatigue failure are higher in case of vertical axis turbines due to natural resonances occurring in the structure. And one blade comes in the wake region of the other and thus produces extra stress. So the blade which is on the front side faces the wind first, right? So that disturbs the flow, and the next blade may come in the path of that. So this is one difficulty with the vertical axis turbine. Now let's talk about certain terminologies of related with the wind energy. So one of the term which will be very commonly used is power coefficient, CP. This is actually nothing but what we commonly or use the word efficiency. So the power coefficient is basically what is the input. So input is the power in the wind. So it will be shown that power in the wind, which is flowing at a velocity of u, is 1/2 rho a u cube. It will be shown. And the power that you produced is the turbine power, PT. So first we are talking about only mechanical power, the turbine, and then comes the inefficiency of the maybe coupling and then the generator, etc. But the kinetic energy of the wind is converted into mechanical energy by the turbine. So we are talking about that efficiency. So that is also the other word used, is coefficient of power. Then lift and drag coefficient. So the machines may actually not be purely lift type and purely drag type, though the predominant dominant part or component could be lift or could be drag, but the other one may also be contributing, or it may be the case that the other one is actually reducing the effect of the other. So there is an effect of lift force as well as drag force coefficient present in most of the turbines. So these two coefficients are defined as the lift coefficient is the lift force divided by 1/2 rho a u square. So 1/2 rho a u square is the kinetic energy in the wind, and then the drag force. So these are all non-dimensional numbers, so don't have any units. It will be a fraction, and generally the highest value will be 1. Generally, I'm saying FD is drag force divided by 1/2 rho a u square is the drag coefficient. So these are the terminologies which we may use in future. So they are being defined here. Thrust coefficient is the thrust force divided by the kinetic energy, that is 1/2 rho a u square. Then another one, an important one in the practical discussions about the wind turbines, is the tip speed ratio. So tip is the tip of the blade, which is having radius equal to, let's say, R. At some places I have used capital R, so maybe here also we can replace this with capital R. So the R is the radius of the turbine, or it is the length of the blade. So at what speed or what is the velocity at the tip of the blade? It is omega into R, right? So the omega is the angular velocity and R is the radius or the length of the blade. So omega R, the velocity at the tip of the blade, divided by the wind velocity, small u is the wind velocity. So the ratio of these two is called tip speed ratio. So with respect to wind speed, how high is the velocity of the tip of the blade? That is given by the tip speed ratio. And it will be shown that though the efficiency or power coefficient for an ideal turbine does not depend upon the tip speed ratio, for actual turbines it depends upon the tip speed ratio. Next terminology is solidity of turbine. This is actually like whenever you see a fan or a turbine, what you can see is some area, like when you rotate them, they basically produce a plane of rotation.
Right.
Now, let's when it is steady, that circle, the plane of rotation, some area is occupied by the blade and the remaining area is a gap. So the ratio of the area occupied by the blades divided by the total pi r square of that plane is nothing but the solidity of the turbine. So if you have a two-bladed fan, let's say, then it will occupy less area, right? And if you have a three-bladed fan, then it will occupy more area, like if the of this size is same. Okay. So you might have observed that it may not be very common, but some fans come with particularly kind of pedestrian fans. They come with two blades and they generally rotate very fast compared to the three-bladed one. Or the motor used there is giving much higher RPM. Okay, so similar thing will also be seen in case of a wind turbine. So solidity is also one factor which distinguishes various types of turbines. So solidity is ratio of W into R into N. So W is the width of the blade, R is the length of the blade. Okay. R is the length of the blade and number of blades. Okay, so that's the area occupied by the blades and the total area of the plane that is given by A. So that ratio is called the solidity of the turbine. Yeah, so that may also be called swept area. Okay, so that may also be called the swept area, the area of the circular plane in which the blades are rotating. So solidity of turbine, and then now we are interested to first know how much is the energy in the wind. Well, like in case of solar energy, we started talking about how much is the extraterrestrial solar energy. So that's the maximum limit, and then by the time it reaches on the surface of the earth, different parts of it have been subjected to different types of phenomena like the absorption and scattering, etc. So similar to that, or let's say even in case of a heat engine, you define the Carnot cycle efficiency. So even theoretically, you cannot exceed a particular value, that is this 1 minus T2 upon T1 in case of a heat engine, right, where T1 and T2 are the source and sink temperatures. So you can, if an engine is working between T1 and T2, your efficiency can never exceed 1 minus T2 upon T1. So that's the limit of that's the theoretical limit. So similarly here, we want to find out first how much is the energy in the wind, and the next thing will be stating the theoretical limit. So how much is the energy in the wind? It can be, that equation can be derived with a very simple discussion. So let's say there is a parcel of air as shown in the figure whose density is rho, and it passes through a particular cross-sectional area A and its velocity is u. So if the mass of this parcel is m, then how much is the kinetic energy contained by this? It is 1/2 mu square. U is the velocity of the wind. But this is energy, right? When you say power, it is per unit time. Right, so in that case, the power in the wind is nothing but 1/2 m dot. Okay, so this is mass flow rate. The previous one is the mass, and here it is mass flow rate u square. Okay, so 1/2 m dot u square. So m dot is nothing but rho a u, right, under steady conditions. So 1/2 rho a u cube is the power in the wind. So if the wind is air is having density equal to rho. Your cross-sectional area through which the air passes is A and velocity of the wind is U, then the power in wind is 1/2 rho A U cube. Let's say like this density rho is around say 1.15 kg per meter cube. Area, let's say you take 1 meter square, then this will reduce to 0.647 u cube.
Right.
So the velocity of the wind is the single most important parameter in case of wind turbines, whether they are able to produce higher power or not able to produce a higher power. The wind velocity is very, very important. You can see it is the cube of the velocity which is affecting the power. So if you are talking about a wind velocity of 5 meter per second, then the power density is the power available per meter square area, would be 87 watt per meter square. While at 10 meter per second, it will become 8 times of that, right? So that would be around 647 watt per meter square. So it's very important, like when you take a decision whether a place is good for setting up a wind turbine or wind farm or not, the most important parameter is that the velocity of the wind throughout the year or most of the time of the year, there should be high wind velocity available at that place. So based on that consideration or the measurements that are done at that site, you will decide whether it's a good place to set up a wind turbine or not, or set up a wind farm or not. Okay, so here it is just with the help of a chart and a figure, it is shown how the velocity affects the power in the wind or the power density. So you can see it's a kind of okay, it rises very rapidly, obviously, because it is the cube of the velocity which is affecting the power density. And here on the right hand side, the effect of the radius or length of the blade, radius of the turbine or length of the blade is shown. So a 27 meter turbine may produce 225 kilowatt, right, at a particular velocity of the wind, while here 54, so double of that, you produce 1000, right? So almost four times, because it is pi r square, the area is increasing proportional to the square of the radius. Okay, so the one would obviously like to put up a turbine with very long blades, whatever is technically possible. So over the years, wind turbine heights, and because of that, the radius also can be increased. So heights have been, there is another reason also why height should be more, which will be discussed in due course of time. But at least when you have higher height, you can accommodate more length of the blade. And because of that, your cross-sectional area reduces, and this is going vertical. So with the same footprint, you are able to produce much, much higher power. So it's always a good idea to put up a turbine with a very long blade. Okay, now let's talk about the theoretical limit of the energy conversion, and it's called Bed's model. So here, if there is a turbine at a particular place or a cross section, it's not that that the air which is just before the turbine has a particular velocity and pressure, and it changes across the turbine. Okay, so it's not a very like a location specific phenomena. It is found that when you put up a turbine and it starts using the energy of the wind to convert it into mechanical energy, the velocity upstream of that up to some distance is also affected, and the velocity downstream to that is also affected, and the same thing is with pressure. So it is seen that, let's say you have some measuring instruments with the help of which you can measure the velocity and pressure, and also that velocity measured is, let's say, velocity at a point, and you move that and check where all you find the reduction in velocity and in change in pressure. So here there is a turbine shown, though I have shown the blades of the turbine. Actually, as per this theory, it is assumed to be just in one plane, right? So it may be shown as just a line, a thin actuating disc, you can call it. Okay, so this is an theoretical model with the help of which you are defining the limit of the power conversion. Right, you know how much power is there in the wind. If you have wind at velocity u, you know that the power in the wind is 1/2 rho a u cube. But whether you can convert all wind power into mechanical power, okay, based on your engineering experience, you will immediately say that no, that would not happen. But then you have to justify it with the help of certain derivations. Okay, so even theoretically, that's not possible, and then practical considerations could even reduce it further. So this model shows the turbine plane. Actually, here you may just show a plane here, which is the turbine plane, and just upstream of that is 0.2, just downstream of that is 0.3, and it is seen that as the air approaches, let's say the free wind much away from the wind turbine is having velocity equal to u1. It is seen that as it approaches the turbine, the velocity is continuously decreasing. So that kind of plot is shown here in this diagram. Okay, you may not look at the numbers here, 2/3 of U1 and 1/3 of U1. It will be shown, and that's for a very, very specific case. But what would be observed is the wind, the free air velocity is U1, but near the turbine, as it approaches the turbine, it is seen that the velocity would continuously decrease. And it's a continuous flow, so there won't be any disturbance in that. Disturbance, what I mean is on the micro scale, there won't be any disturbance, right? So there is a continuous kind of smooth flow through this. So the velocity is steadily and continuously decreasing, and even beyond the turbine, it is seen that it still goes on decreasing, and then at some point it becomes minimum. Okay, if you are able to measure pressure, what is seen is the pressure P1 is the atmospheric pressure, or the pressure, the ambient pressure, the pressure area where you have put up the turbine. It is seen that as you approach the turbine, the pressure continuously increases. So this is the static pressure continuously increasing. It is seen that there is a sudden drop of pressure as the kinetic energy is converted into mechanical energy. There is a sudden drop of pressure, and it goes to negative pressure, okay, negative gauge pressure, and then that is slowly recovered, and again the pressure becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure or the ambient pressure. So the area in which these effects are shown, that is called a stream tube. So that tube, it's an imaginary tube, it has been shown here. Okay, now for this kind of flow, what would be the limit of the power produced? That is what is found. Okay, so it's basically linear momentum theorem. So the considerations are very means the equations that are written are based on the Newton's law of motion. So the thrust force is nothing but the change in momentum. So that's m dot into u1 minus u4. Now what are these suffix? You should remember this suffix. So one is at the entry, that is free wind. Two is just upstream of the wind turbine. Three is just downstream of the wind turbine. And four is at the exit of the stream tube, or that's the minimum velocity, the point at which velocity is minimum and the point at which the pressure reduction has been recovered, and now the pressure is equal to the ambient pressure. So what is the maximum change in the velocity? It is u1 minus u4. So that thrust force is m dot into u1 minus u4, and the power is ft into the velocity at the turbine cross section. So that is u2. So when you multiply u2, you get the power produced by the turbine, and this is theoretical power. M dot into, so now you put the value of ft, you get m dot into u1 minus u4 into u2, right? So now loss of kinetic pt is the power produced, so that should be energy conservation, that should be equal to the rate of change of kinetic energy. So that is 1 half m dot u1 minus u4 square. So you rewrite it as u1 minus u4 into u1 plus u4. Now you compare, if you compare these two, what you find is that this u2 is 1 half of u1 plus u4, or you can write u4 as 2u2 minus u1. So now in this equation m dot u1 minus u4 into u2, you replace this u4 with u2 and u1. So what you get is 2 rho a2 u2 square into u1 minus u2. Now there is a parameter now defined here. It is called intercept factor. This intercept factor A is defined as the ratio of decrease in velocity of wind at turbine section to the original velocity. So what is the decrease? It is u1 minus u2. And what is the original? It is u1. So that ratio is given a name, intercept factor, and the notation is A. Now you would like to present the equations in terms of the intercept factor. So this u2 is 1 minus a into u1, and then substituting for u2, you get this form of equation. So that's 4a into, final form is 4a into 1 minus a square into, you are interested to get this term, 1 half rho a2 u1 cube, because that's the power in the wind. So you could rewrite this equation for power produced by turbine as 1 half rho a 2 u1 square. This is the power in the wind, Pw. And there is a multiplying factor. And this multiplying factor, as you can think of, maximum value can be 1. But then whether it can reach 1 or not, so you have to at what value of a will the power become maximum? That is what you have to find. So for that, what you can do is, so this the way you had defined this CP, it's nothing but CP is defined as PT into PT upon PW. So this 4a into 1 minus a whole square must be CP, the coefficient of power. And if you plot turbine power versus, or rather, if you plot intercept factor versus CP, it is seen that as A increases, this is the equation which relates them. So it is seen that as A increases, CP continuously increases, but then there is a maximum value and then it starts decreasing. So there is some value, optimum value of A for which CP becomes maximum. So what is that value of A? We are interested to know that value of A. So you differentiate CP with respect to A and equate it to zero. So from that you can get two values of a equal to 1 and a equal to 1 by 3. Now if you put a equal to 1, then CPU would become equal to 0. So that doesn't give you the maximum value of CPU. And if you put a equal to 1 by 3, then CPU value would be this 4a into 1 minus a whole square would be equal to 16 by 27. So that's 0.593 or 59.3% is the highest possible value of coefficient of power or the efficiency of the turbine as per this theory. So this is also called bed's limit. So no turbine can give you efficiency more than 59.3% as per this theory. Actual turbines generally give you even lower efficiencies, right? So they give 35-40% efficiency. But as per the Bed's theorem or the linear momentum theorem, the maximum value of CP, coefficient of power or efficiency of a turbine, can be 59.3%. So your PT turb maximum can be 16 by 27 into 1 half rho A U cube. So 1 half rho A U cube is the power available in the wind. Okay. So if you put these values, you will find that your U2, that is the velocity at the turbine section, is two-third of U1, that is the free stream velocity of the wind, and U4 would be one-third of U1. Okay, at the maximum power coefficient, those will be the value of U2 is equal to U3 and U4. Okay. In case of actual turbines, the overall efficiency is also affected by the electrical power conversion from mechanical power as you use the generator. Now thrust and thrust coefficient. Thrust is important because it works axially, and the stability of the turbine and the foundation depends upon that. So we think about the thrust coefficient, what could be the maximum value of thrust coefficient and the thrust force. So again, the U2 is written in terms of A and U1. And U4 is also written in terms of A and U1. And then you put it in the formula for PT, the power produced by the turbine, right? It is equal to the rate of change of the kinetic energy. Okay. But then your PT is also equal to the thrust force into U2. So thrust force is the rate of change of the kinetic energy. If you divide this with U2, you get the thrust force. So that's how it is written, and then modified to write it in terms of U1 and A. So what you get is it is equal to 1 half rho A to U1 square into 4A into 1 minus A. Okay. So the thrust coefficient is thrust force divided by 1 half rho A U1 square. So the thrust coefficient is nothing but 4a into 1 minus a. It can be found in the other way also by writing the thrust as the rate of change of momentum. But finally, Ct is equal to Ft upon 1 half rho a u1 square. So Ct is equal to, it is equal to 4a into 1 minus a. So that's the value of Ct, the thrust coefficient, right? So Ct will be 1, maximum value of Ct can be 1, and it will occur at A equal to 0.5. If A is equal to 0.5, then Ct would be 1. But at that time, U4 will become 0. U4 will become 0. So the velocity of the air coming out of the turbine is equal to 0, right? Now, is that possible? Obviously, that is not possible. If you make that air stagnant, how the fresh air will come? So you cannot extract all air, all power out of air, right? राइट एज वी लाइक देर इज अ प्रोवर्ब इन गुजराती के मीठा झरना मूड ना खाई खाई जवाय राइट सो एंड मीठा झरना मूड खाई जाओ तो पछी झरनू ज अस्तित्व ना रहे सो सेम इफ यू टेक अवे ऑल एनर्जी फ्रॉम द विंड इट कैन नॉट गो फर्दर सो इट विल स्टॉप देयर एंड इट कैन देन फ्रेश एयर कैन नॉट कम so all energy out of the wind you have to allow means leave kinetic energy which is required to go out of that cross section okay. so that's not a feasible thing right so you cannot go up to ct equal to 1 okay. so when your a is equal to 1 by 3 you get the maximum power and your interest might be to get the maximum power so you may put value of a equal to 1 by 3 or you may operate the turbine such that a is equal to 1 by 3 so in that case ct would be 8 by 9 that is 4a into 1 minus a so if you put a equal to 1 by 3 ct would be 8 by 9 right so how much will be the thrust force at that point of time it will be 8 by 9 into 1 half rho a u1 square So that would be the thrust force which should be, which is to be withstood by the structure, the tower and the foundation. Okay. So how do you ensure that this force doesn't become so high that it will damage the structure and tower or maybe even blades? So what you have to be careful is you as you know the power in the wind is 1 half rho a u cube so as the velocity goes on increasing you get more and more power right but again there you have to put a limit you can't be very greedy so you have to put a limit otherwise the thrust force would be so high that it can damage the turbine so at some speed somewhere around 15 to 20 meters per second depending upon the design of the blade you have to take some remedial measure so that the turbine is not damaged so but there are different ways in which that might be done certain things are written here four different strategies are written here you may not be able to understand it completely as of now as we cover more and more theory you will better understand that so one of them can be yawing the turbine out of the wind so changing the direction so this is changing the direction of the plane in which this is rotating okay so that is yawing it will be explained what exactly is yawing the second strategy can be lessen the power extraction and hence thrust by pitching the blades or extending spoil flaps right so there is one control mechanism called pitching so that also may be adopted actually pitching is basically rotating the blades about its own axis one of the objective of that is to operate the turbine at optimum condition so that it gives you the maximum possible efficiency but then at very high wind speeds you might actually want to reduce the efficiency so even that can be done with the help of pitching then if you don't want to like your design is not such that you can rotate the blades then you have to lessen the power extraction and hence thrust by pitching the blades or extending spoil flaps now the third one to design fixed blades so that they become extremely inefficient and self stalling in large winds at large wind speed so in that case it's fixed blades and the design is such that at very high velocity it starts becoming very inefficient right and even stalling starts and you are not able to produce much power So that way also you can save the turbine. And stop rotation by blade pitching and or braking. Right? So you pitch the blade out of the wind, and it hardly produces any power, and or the other measure could be to stop it by braking. Okay. So out of this, it is stated that the method three, that is using this fixed blades with self-stalling, that is at very high wind speeds, it stop. It is at high speeds, it is becoming very inefficient, and that that's how you reduce the thrust force. And then the method two is generally preferred, though three might look simple, but two is what is preferred, and that is to by the pitching and reducing the power extraction. Then another parameter is torque and torque coefficient, right? So torque is force into the radius of the blade, and the maximum torque when your force is maximum. The thrust force can be maximum when thrust coefficient is equal to 1. So in that case, your Ft would be 1/2 rho a u1 square. So your maximum torque can be 1/2 rho a u1 square into r. Now tip speed ratio is omega r upon u1. Okay. So you are putting the value of r from this equation. So you get maximum torque 1/2 rho a u1 square lambda u1 upon omega. And then you're recombining various terms, 1/2 rho a u1 cube and into lambda upon rho. Now this 1/2 rho a u cube is nothing but the power in the wind. So this maximum torque is power in the wind into lambda upon omega, right? Lambda is the tip speed ratio, omega is the angular velocity, right? So your PW is maximum torque into omega upon lambda. Now your CP, power coefficient, is PT upon PW. So if you put the value of PW from here, and PT is nothing but whatever is the actual torque into omega into omega, so that's PT, and then you put the value of PW. So basically what you get is the relation between CP and CT, CP and CT, right? So CP is equal to CT into lambda, or CT is equal to, CT is nothing but the torque coefficient, so that's torque upon the maximum torque, that is CP upon lambda. So if your CP is equal to, what is the maximum value of CP? 0.5926, right? So if you put that, if you are operating the turbine at that CP, let's say, so this will become a constant, and then your CT would depend upon the value of lambda. As you go on increasing lambda, CT will reduce. Now, what is the importance of the term CT, the torque coefficient? You may be also interested in the torque, and particular there could be some applications where high torque is important. Okay. So so that might be the interest in the value of CT. Of course, torque also helps you produce higher power for a given, if the speed is constant, right? But sometimes the torque may be low, but the speed may be high, and that's how also you are interested, you can produce power. So for electrical power production, like generally high speeds are of more interest than the high torque, but some applications like water pumping and milling, grinding, etc., the torque, high torque may be what is desired. So CT would vary like this. At constant value of CP, as you go on increasing lambda, the CT value will fall. But this is the theoretical thing. It is found that in the actual turbines, the variation of CT with respect to lambda is different. And again, the plots are shown for two different varieties of turbines, or two different categories of turbine. The solidity was defined. So there could be some turbines with high solidity HS, there could be some turbines with low solidity. Okay. So turbines having many number of blades, for example, American multi-blade is high solidity turbine, and the turbine having less number of blades, so the horizontal axis propeller type of turbine having one blade, two blade, three blade, so that's having low solidity. It is seen that the high solidity turbines are able to give you higher CT. Okay, it's able to give you higher CT, and that too at low value of lambda. So at low speed of rotation, they provide you the highest value of torque coefficient. And in case of the low solidity turbines, you cannot expect very high torque coefficient. As you can see, the peak of this curve is low, and that too even occurs at high value of lambda. So the low solidity turbines are generally rotated at much higher speed than the high solidity turbines. That's the important information that you get from some means from the derivation that is that was done. So then there is a small discussion on drag machines. What could be the maximum efficiency of a drag machine? So ideal drag machine, one such drag machine or mechanism to convert the kinetic energy into the mechanical energy using the drag force is shown. So the drag force is nothing but the change in the conversion of the net kinetic energy. Okay, so that's U1 minus V is the net velocity of the blade. So that is the drag force. And then the actual drag force would there'll be a multiplier here, CD, okay, into 1/2 A into U1 minus V, the net velocity square of that. The CD is the drag coefficient. So power transmitted to the flap would be the force into the velocity at which it is rotating. And so that would become equal to CD into V by 2 rho A U1 minus V whole square. And you can see that when value of V is U1 upon 3, this will become maximum. So if you put the value of U equal to U1 upon 3, then this is the equation that you get. And here you have 1/2 rho a U1 cube. That is the power in the wind. And here the multiplier is 4 by 27, not 16 by 27, and then CD. So you can see that the efficiency or the power coefficient in case of drag turbines is expected to be low. This is just 4 by 27. Even if your CD is more than one, which might be possible in some cases, still it will be much higher than. So even if CD is equal to 1.5, which might be possible in concave shaped object like cup type of anemometer, so still the CP would be 27.27, right? So again, much lower than 59.2% in case of lift machine. So conceptually, principally also the drag machines cannot provide you very high power coefficient. So that's the one of the reason why lift machines, the machines which you use lift force mainly, are more popular.